versus Amazon.com. And we have, I thought, two. Oh, Mr. Parnes is still there. But let's wait. Okay. Let's wait till we have the people that we're looking for. Well, we can go ahead. We'll start with Ms. Hunt.
Morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. I'm here representing plaintiff putative class in this wage action, which is brought exclusively under Oregon state law against Amazon. This action is about the compensability of time spent in security screenings that Amazon requires of its employees as an anti-theft measure. That issue already has been resolved in favor of compensability under the state laws of Arizona, Nevada, and Pennsylvania. This court has also addressed the same issue and found in favor of compensability, specifically with regards to Apple's security screenings by applying California law. In each of those cases, what is controlling is the state's rules of statutory interpretation, along with the state's regulation or statute governing hours worked. In Oregon, hours worked specifically means all hours an employee is required to give to the employer, all time during which an employee is on the employer's premises. It also includes work time, which is defined by statute as only time worked and time of authorized attendance. Those definitions and provisions are broader than most of the courts cited in the Amazon cases. Despite that, and despite Oregon's adherence to text and context being primary in interpreting its statutes, the district court erroneously ruled that the time spent in Amazon security screenings was not compensable and gave three reasons. One, the broad provisions of Oregon's work time and hours worked law should cover all types of activity. So therefore, Oregon's rule, which is specifically directed to the compensability of specified preparatory and concluding activities of employees, the district court concluded would make that rule a nullity or superfluous because it's already covered. That directly misunderstands the role of BOLI in this state. And I'm sorry if I'm using terms unfamiliar. BOLI is
Bureau of Labor and Industries.
We're with you.
Thank you. Justin, every state has a different name for its regulatory body. So the rule, the statute that authorizes BOLI to act specifically empowers BOLI to make such rules as the commissioner considers appropriate to carry out the purposes of ORS Chapter 653, which is at issue here in terms of the work time definition. And any rule that is necessary to prevent the circumvention or evasion of that statutory chapter and to establish and safeguard the minimum wage rates provided therein. So that is the rule at issue. That is the authorization for BOLI to act. So BOLI does make many regulations that are more specific and apply to specific groups and how the work time and hours worked is going to be applied to those groups.
Counsel?
So there's no...
Counsel, we've read your briefs and I appreciate them. Both parties have really presented excellent argument. I've got a chart here because I asked my clerk to help me figure out how these other cases have come down. And it seems like it's a mixed bag that depends largely upon the actual language used in various states and how closely it really mirrors the Portal to Portal Act. So my question for you is, that's my premise, my question for you is, how does your case stack up against the others?
Well, the strongest case in terms of statutory interpretation, and actually that may change. So the Arizona case is very similar to ours. You effectuate legislative intent in construing statutes. Equally fundamental is what the equally fundamental is the presumption that what the legislature means, it will say.
Right, but in Arizona, there isn't statutory language modeled after the Portal to Portal to Act, you know, in the same way that we have here, you know, specifically from the regulation in Oregon.
And that's, thank you for that question, because fundamentally, if in Oregon, as is true, we have to emphasize the text mm-hmm. and the context. And by the way, context doesn't mean let's go run to the FLSA. Context means in Oregon to look at related statutes in the same statutory provision.
Right.
Or,
Council, but here's my problem. I'm just going to be very direct about it because
yes.
I don't know that it's all even appropriate for us to be ruling on this as opposed to certifying, which is a separate question. But I was distracted by your brief telling me for pages and pages what the regulation doesn't do. And so I'm asking you to please focus on the regulation in Oregon that includes this preparatory and concluding activities are considered hours worked if the activities are considered an integral and indispensable part of a principal activity for which the person is employed. And you know this language. I'm probably in your sleep by now, right?
No,
That strikes me as pretty closely mirroring or certainly coming a whole lot closer to the Portal Act language than the other cases that you just mentioned. And if Arizona is your closest, you think Arizona is your strongest?
I was talking about the statutory interpretation methodology.
Okay, well, I'm talking about the language in the regulation.
Okay.
So can you go to that, please?
I will absolutely go to that. Thank you. The rule in Oregon does not evidence an intent to adopt the Portal to Portal Act. The Portal to Portal Act, as it functions, is to protect the employers. It's to exclude from compensability certain, and they use preliminary and post-liminary activities that are not integral and indispensable. Oregon's rule does not say that we're going to exclude from compensability
I know, and that's what I was telling you. Your brief tells me what it doesn't do. But it seems to me what Oregon does do is use language that pretty closely, and perhaps more so than these other states, mirror the language of the Portal to Portal Act. So could you please direct your attention to that? I grant you there's no place where the legislature said we're going to adopt the Portal to Portal Act. I get that.
The big difference is what Oregon does in this is say what's compensable. This rule shows an awareness of the fact that the Portal to Portal Act existed, and by specifically choosing to not protect the employer, because that's not what BOLI is empowered to do, it's just, you know, using some of the same language and saying what is compensable. Where the district court went wrong is saying that, well, that must imply that, you know, the Portal to Portal Act has been adopted, and by implication, this rule then will follow the Portal to Portal Act and talk about what's excluded.
Yeah, that's a question that I had. The rule in question appears, I haven't gone back to the original documents, but on its face, it appears that it was first enacted in 1990, or promulgated in 1990. So if it was promulgated then, what was the state of the law under the borrowed text, that is under the Portal to Portal Act at that time? In other words, if something is adopted from another source, another statute or whatever, presumably people know what it means then, but that doesn't mean necessarily that they'll accept any interpretation of it made 10 or 20 or 30 years later. What was understood at the time in 1990 about these kinds of activities under the Portal to Portal Act?
I have no idea. I can't divine what was in the legislature's head.
No, no, that's not what I'm asking you. I'm asking you what was the law, the extant law in 1990 that had developed thus far under the Portal to Portal Act.
So it's a backdrop against which they were legislating, if I understand.
Right, right.
I still don't know that I am capable of answering that question. Okay. I don't know what the state of the law was at 1990. What I will say is the statutory interpretation methodology in this state dictates less and less reliance on the FLSA. So when you look at, since we are going to have to put you in the shoes of the Oregon Supreme Court, when you look at the Oregon Supreme Court, it doesn't interpret wage actions under the Portal to Portal Act or under anything other than the plain text of the actual statute or rule. So, and in fact, I actually looked to see when the last time was that the Oregon Supreme Court cited to the FLSA at all. And that was in 2007. And in that case, it was North Marion School District number 15. It was distinguishing the FLSA. And previous to that, it had considered similar claims as this one and still ruled without referring to the FLSA at all. So our Oregon Supreme Court will not rely on the FLSA to understand what this rule means. Also, when you look at the evolution of the cases in the Court of Appeals, that I can speak to, most of the cases then were, actually they were all, the older cases were dealing with the definitions of employee, employer, and employee, and those were all terms that were deemed to have been adopted from the FLSA and analyzed consistently with the FLSA. And that was a 1989 case, Northwest Advancement, 2011, DeNicola, and then also Cejas, which was 2013. Thereafter, and as our statutory interpretation method, I think, got stronger and took hold, Nkrumah came out and said, well, that doesn't apply to ORS Chapter 652. And never have we said that the FLSA applies there. And it relied on straight definitions of employ in Chapter 653 and came out differently, saying this has a different meaning than those previous cases. There's a 2016, Mr. DeNicola was apparently very busy, another DeNicola case that came out in 2016 out of the Court of Appeals. And again, looking at employer and employee as it was defined in another provision. So, and then that court came out saying it's defined differently from those in the FLSA. And then come forward to 2016 in Migas, employees that spent time between opening, closing the stores on personal tasks was deemed irrelevant under Oregon's wage and hour statutes definition of work time and hours worked. So, you know, if time shows anything, it's that when you look at this rule, it has to be construed on its terms. And it can't be evidence that we've adopted the Portal to Portal Act unless it actually says explicitly, not impliedly, explicitly, that we have adopted or that we have included the exclusion that the Portal to Portal Act is addressed to. And the Pennsylvania court was pretty sharp about, this was a certified question to the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, and it determined that the FLSA, and I think this is true, it establishes only a national floor under which wage protections cannot drop. But more generous protections provided by a state are not precluded. And taken together with what BOLI is authorized to do, that this act is, again, about compensability. It's about protection of the workers, and it is consistent with the court's statutory statement of policy for all of the provisions of Chapter 652, including these claims. It's the public policy of this state that no person shall be hired nor permitted to work for wages under any conditions or terms for longer days, blah, 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 blah. And it's supposed, in each statute has to be fashioned with an eye towards the person's health and physical well-being and ability to promote the general welfare by the person's increasing usefulness as a healthy and intelligent citizen.
Counsel, you've used your time, okay. But we will give you a minute for rebuttal when the time comes.
Thank you.
Mr. Keneally?
Thank you, Your Honor, and may it please the court. My name is Michael Keneally, and I represent the Amazon defendants. I'd like to just pick up with Judge Kristen's question, because I wholeheartedly agree that the cases on this security screening issue under various states' law is a bit of a mixed bag. I think, though, that the Oregon regulation that we've relied on and that the district court relied on is much stronger evidence of a state law intent to adopt the standard that the Supreme Court applied in Busk than anything
cases. The regulation on which you rely was adopted initially in 1990, as I read it. What was the state of the law under the Portal to Portal Act in 1990? Do you know
the state
answer?
Of the law under the Portal to Portal Act was the same as it is today, except we didn't have the benefit of, you know, the Supreme Court's guidance about security.
But the concern that I have is this: even assuming that, and I'm not necessarily agreeing with this, but let's assume that the legislature enacts a statute in 1990. We're talking about a regulation, but it's easier for me to think in terms of the statute. Are you there?
In 1990. Yes, I'm here, Your Honor.
Yeah, no, your pictures keep going away. We sometimes indulge in a presumption that, or perhaps a fiction, but that the statute is adopted in the context of what is known then about the statute. It doesn't necessarily mean that the state legislature is going to be bound by an interpretation that happens 10 or 15 or 20 years later. And I'm particularly concerned about this in Oregon because, as you know, the Oregon Supreme Court has a long history of taking identical provisions of the Constitution and statutes and saying it doesn't mean the same thing here as it means to the federal government. That's true in the context, for example, of search and seizure and many, many other provisions. So why would we make this presumption here without asking the Oregon Supreme Court?
For two reasons, Your Honor. I think first, federal law did not evolve in between 1990 and the present day. We're relying on the same standard that is adopted in the Supreme Court's 1956 decision, Steiner versus Mitchell. That was what the Supreme Court applied in Busk, and it's just stating the test that is reflected in Rule 43, the integral and indispensable to the employee's principal activities test. So we think that the federal law hasn't really changed in a way that implicates this concern. And then the second point, Your Honor, is that while we don't have the Oregon Supreme Court's rulings on these issues, we do have a body of Oregon Court of Appeals precedent that I think is better than not having any guidance. And in fact, the court will often look to the intermediate appellate courts to interpret, to make an eerie prediction about what the Supreme Court would do. And I would take issue with Ms. Hunt's description of those cases in the FLSA context and in the Oregon wage and hour context. I'd highlight the Cejas case from 2013, which specifically endorsed looking at federal precedent and regulations when the Oregon materials adopt a term of art from federal law, which is what Rule 43 does here. And even before the rule was promulgated in 1990 in the Northwest Advancement case, the Court of Appeals ruled similarly. And it, in fact, relied on federal case law that post-dated the statutory provisions that it was interpreting in that case. So I think this is a well-established strand of Oregon wage and hour law, as reflected in many decades of Oregon Court of Appeals decisions. And that is another distinguishing factor between Oregon in this case and the state court's decisions that, you know, your honors are already well familiar with. In California, as you know, the California Supreme Court has held for decades that its wage orders should not be interpreted in a way that gives deference to federal law. But all of the signs we have from Oregon are to the contrary. And there's no indication in anything that Ms. Hunt has... I'm sorry, can your honors hear me okay?
Yes, we can. It's just that your pictures keep flashing in and out, but we can hear you perfectly.
Okay, your honors, that if you can't, just please let me know. Plaintiff has cited nothing that suggests that the Bureau was trying to do something other than follow the standard that the Supreme Court adopted in Steiner versus Mitchell, the integral and indispensable standard. In their reply brief, they rely on the Ramirez declaration that they submitted to the district court. But as we pointed out below, there are a host of problems with relying on that declaration to understand Oregon law. For one thing, it's inconsistent with the contemporaneous indications of the Bureau's intent. And we discussed this at supplemental excerpts of record 21 quoting from the, for lack of a better word, administrative agency legislative history when they were considering the 1990 set of regulations, and said that their desire was to mirror federal law as closely as permissible by statute. The Ramirez Declaration is also not purporting to describe the historical practice of the Bureau. And under the Oregon Supreme Court's ruling in Gaffer versus Legacy Good Samaritan Hospital, the Oregon Supreme Court does not give weight to agency interpretations that are effectively just a declaration that one side in the case should win rather than the other. And then on its own terms, the Ramirez Declaration doesn't purport to address the meaning of Rule 43 in particular. And so we would say it's not probative. I think Judge Kristen mentioned some concerns about maybe we should maybe the court should certify this issue to the Oregon Supreme Court. And if I may just address that issue head on, I would say that there are three reasons why certification would be inappropriate here. The first is that the plaintiff did not seek certification.
Counsel, that's irrelevant. No party has to ask. It's purely within the discretion of our court as to whether to certify. We've certified when both parties want it, when both parties don't want it, when nobody mentions it, when one party wants it and one doesn't. It doesn't make any difference. It's our call. It's not the party's call.
What's your second reason?
Certainly, Your Honor. The second reason is that we think that the issue is clear for the reasons I discussed. If I had to pick my best state as an example for the court to look to, it would be the Kentucky case in Vance, where the Sixth Circuit found it sufficiently clear what Kentucky would do based on general principles of statutory interpretation and also regulatory references to the term principal activity in the Kentucky travel and wait time regulations. And in this case, we have more than that. We not only have principal activity, we have integral and indispensable, which did not exist under Kentucky law. So I would think that this is an easier case than Vance and would say that the issue before the court is sufficiently clear that certification is not necessary. And then my third point on certification is that if the court is inclined to certify, we don't think that the question that the plaintiffs has questions that the plaintiff has proposed would be the right questions to certify, because they're broader, although in a way more fact dependent than the question that the district court answered in this case, which was, as I take it, that if preparatory and concluding activities are not integral and indispensable, then they don't count as hours worked under Rule 43. That's the only question on this first point that the district court resolved, I would submit, and that would be the appropriate way to frame the issues for the Oregon Supreme Court, because here we don't have a record. This is the facts about the security screenings are contested between the parties. And unlike, say, the Amazon...
Excuse me, let me just ask you one thing. Is there, as I understand it, though, there's mandatory screening. Is that correct?
Screening in general, but then there are different options from within the possible opportunities.
Right, but that at least is not a contested fact, that it is mandatory.
It is contested,
rather than
however,
voluntary.
It is contested whether any time is incurred as a result of mandatory screenings.
Right. I understand that. I'm not, that isn't my question. It's not a voluntary activity. So it's possible, I mean, hypothetically, that the Oregon Supreme Court would say it's compensable, and then nobody would have any damages because they're already being paid for the hours involved. But that's a separate question, I think, as to whether it's mandatory and whether it is, I mean, whether it is part of the time of authorized attendance, which is what the statute says about work time.
Well, Your Honor, I raised the point out of concern about the regulatory definition in Rule 419, which talks about hours that the employee is required to give to the employer. And if the facts as developed would go to show, as we say they would be, that employees are not required to give additional time to their employer, but if they spend time in line, it's because they wanted to bring in bags rather than leave them in their lockers, like Amazon encourages them to do. Those are facts that could affect whether the time is required to be given to the employer, but they're not yet in this record because of the threshold question about the effect of Rule 43. Unless the court has further questions about the end of day security screenings, I'll just briefly address the meal break question, although it hasn't come up yet today. And there's no dispute on this record that the Amazon employees are not are relieved of all duties for 30 continuous minutes. That is what the regulation in Rule 50 requires. And there is no support for the contrary contention of the plaintiff. She relies on the Maza case, but in fact, that case supports us by showing that the relevant kind of duty for purposes of a meal break claim is whether the duty is a work duty. And in that case, the Court of Appeal was concerned that the employees were allowed to continue performing their jobs for the benefit of their employer during the supposed meal break. And there's a world of difference between, a workaholic employee who doesn't take the full 30 minutes off from the job and someone who decides to voluntarily stretch their legs and go out of the building and as a result walks under a metal detector.
Counsel, since we're going to, talk about the meal period claim, if we were to certify, it seems to me that this claim is potentially derivative and we should hold it and wait. But the district, if you could set, and then of course, if you were to prevail on whether or not this is time worked, then this claim would go away. But the district court had another reason for thinking that the meal period claim didn't make sense. And I think that was that he surmised that because Oregon law requires that an employee be relieved absolutely of work duties for 30 minutes during a meal period, that necessarily meant for those employees who left the premises that Amazon would be left paying essentially for the 2 or 3 minutes it takes to, transit to and from. But I don't know why that is the case, because there's, of course, time clocks, computerized time clocks for people to walk in and out of. So did the record go into that level of detail?
I think the concern, Your Honor, and without, necessarily conceding about the best interpretation, is that the rule, Rule 50, says that if the employee is not relieved of duties, all duties for 30 continuous minutes, then the employer is required to pay for the entire 30-minute meal period.
Right.
So this isn't just a matter of counting the minutes. It would actually be, as I mentioned, that sort of that point, which is really designed to give the employer a very strong incentive to make sure that the employees are not continuing to perform their jobs and are taking the required time off.
Right. I understand that. And in that way, Oregon law is very similar to several states, maybe all of them in the circuit. So I'm familiar with that, but I'm asking a different question. Could you go to the reasoning that the district court employed for deciding that no matter what happens on the first issue, the second issue could not cut in plaintiff's favor? It strikes me as that it's not necessarily the case. Doesn't it boil down to whether Amazon would in fact be required to cover the transit time, to pay for the transit time, if you will? I'm trying to figure out why that would necessarily be the case.
I didn't interpret the district court to be saying that the meal break claim necessarily falls. I thought that I take the district court's conclusion to be that if the ability to exit the building and the required passing through the metal detector is enough to count as a work duty, that would lead to an absurd result where the employer would basically have an incentive to just prohibit leaving the work site during the meal break,
right.
Which would not promote the regulatory purpose of preserving employee health.
Thank you.
And I see I'm over my time. Unless the court has further questions, we would ask that the decision of the district court be affirmed.
Thank you. Ms. Hunt, you have a little bit of rebuttal time.
Very little bit. Real quickly on the meal period rule, again, it says what it says. One provision of the meal period rule says that an employer must provide the 30 minutes, but to avoid having to pay those wages, that falls under 2B of the rule. They must be relieved of 30 continuous minutes. As far as any differences, one thing I do want to say before I'm gone, in terms of looking at the rule, this court should keep in mind that Boley does not have the authority on its own to suddenly decide to adopt federal law. That is not within Boley's power. Lastly, the absurd results maxim is improperly applied, and it ultimately doesn't matter in certified questions. That's under this court's decision in Sen and also in Frilken versus Apple. And the Supreme Court has said absurd results are not enough to thwart the clearly stated legislative policy. When the intent of the legislature is clear, the absurd result maxim simply doesn't matter. And it's actually typically applied when a court finds two plausible meanings for a statute. Am I over?
You are over, but you may finish your sentence.
I'm so sorry. I was watching the time click and I thought, oh, I can keep going. Thank you. Thank you, Your Honors.
Thank you, counsel. The case just argued is submitted, and we appreciate very much the helpful comments from both of you, and we are adjourned for this morning's session.